Hey everybody, I hope you are all doing well this evening. Today, on week 6, we are going to be discussing animal evolution and just filling out some tables. I just want to say before we get started, if you've looked at the blank worksheet, I don't want you to get too overwhelmed. We are going to work through all of these invertebrate phyla, but just keep track mostly of where a new change happens, and don't try to get too bogged down into the nitty-gritty of each of this. It's more supposed to be a journey through evolution through animals that can help you understand where certain things popped up in evolution, when they came about. So with that said, let's go ahead and get started. The first table we're going to look at is just what can we learn about the evolution of animal kingdom by examining modern invertebrates. To do this, we're going to fill in the chart on this page and the next and organize the major characteristics of each key invertebrate phyla. Starting with Porifera, which are mostly just sponges, the number of tissue layers in the embryo doesn't apply. We don't see tissues at this level, especially not in the embryonic stage. Quasi-level tissue just means that it's almost tissue, but we cannot quite classify it as such yet, so we just say that it's quasi-tissue level, not quite there. There are no true muscle cells, and there is no real symmetry. There's no cephalization, which is just like control, nervous system, main area of where things go through. So there's no cephalization. They live a mostly sessile lifestyle where they just attach to a surface that is where they get their nutrients from. All right, Cendaria. Examples of Cendaria are hydra, corals, jellyfish, and this is when we see the number of tissue layers in an embryo develop, where we have two layers, one that is an ectoderm and one that is an endoderm. And just remember that an ectoderm is the outermost layer of the primary germ cells, but the endoderm is the innermost layer of that early embryo. Tissue versus organ level development. Right here, we're not seeing organ development, but we are seeing tissue level development. For the true muscle cells, they still do not have true muscle cells at this point. They have epithelial muscular cells, but they're not considered true, so we would say no. And in terms of their symmetry, they have radial symmetry, so this is the first time we're seeing symmetry. But they still have no cephalization, and they have a sessile lifestyle. So I'm just going to put that here, like that. Awesome. And now moving on to the platyhelminths. I practiced this over and over and I still got it wrong. Platyhelminthes, I think. Anyway, examples of these organisms are flatworms. And this includes planaria, flukes, and tapeworms. And in terms of their number of tissue layers in the embryo, this is the first time that we start seeing three layers. So we have now an ectoderm, as we've seen before, introducing the mesoderm, and then continuing on seeing that endoderm once more. The endoderm and the mesoderm in this case is what allows for the evolution of circulatory systems and true muscles, and so seeing this mesoderm is very important, just understanding this kind of leap through evolution. And so what this means is tissue versus organ level development is that it is at tissue level, but we're now starting to see the beginnings of organs and the reproductive system. Reproductive system. Sorry, these boxes are a little small. This is also the first time we're seeing true muscle cells. And here we have bilateral symmetry. We also see a movement from nocephalization, where we're starting to see appearance of cephalization, where it's not in full, but it is starting to come about. And along with the appearance of cephalization, we're also seeing the appearance of locomotion. If you can't read my handwriting and it's a little too tiny, don't worry, the key will be released for this, and those answers are typed in, much easier to see. All right, nematoda. Examples are roundworms. This includes Osiris, horsehair worms, things like that. And in terms of tissue layers and embryo, just so you know, what I'll be using as an abbreviation is S, which just means same as previous box. And I say that now because I'm just going to be putting an S here because it has the same number of tissue layers in the embryo as the platyhelminthes. So it has 3: ectoderm, mesoderm, endoderm. Here, instead of just tissue level and beginnings of organ, we see now that this organism is at the organ level. It has organs, and they're true muscle cells. Can be now further characterized into being longitudinally arranged muscle cells. In terms of their symmetry, it is the same as the previous box, so they are bilateral symmetry, and they have the appearance of cephalization and locomotion. Annelida, examples are earthworms, leeches, fanworms. And these are also known as segmented worms. They have the same 3 layers: ectoderm, mesoderm, endoderm. They are at the organ level, and that's the same. Here, for their true muscles, it is the same. And that they are longitudinal, but they are also now circular muscles. symmetry is the same. They are bilateral, and they have the appearance of cephalization. All right, for mollusca, examples are clams, oysters, and snails. They have the same number of layers of tissue in the embryo. They are at the organ level, same here. Their muscle cells show increased complexity in general, so we will just say increased complexity of muscular system. And their symmetry is the same. What we're specifically saying about the tissue layer is just about the layers that we're seeing in the embryo. So the tissues that we're seeing in the developmental embryo of Annelida and Nematoda both have three layers. So both of their embryos have an ectoderm, a mesoderm, and an endoderm is what they're saying. The main difference too between nematodes and annelids are that annelids are segmented and nematodes are unsegmented. Annelids also have a true colon. Nematodes have a pseudocolumate. So there's a lot of differences between the two, but it's just those it's just the embryonic tissue that's the same. So thanks for that clarifying question. For arthropods. Some examples are insects, crabs, lobsters, and crayfish. They have the same number of layers in the embryo. They are at the organ level, so we put an S here. They also have an increased complexity of the muscle system, and they are bilateral symmetry and appearance of cephalization as well as locomotion. Finally, at the end here, we have Echinodermata. Some examples are starfish, sea cucumbers, urchins, or sea urchins, I guess I should specify, and sand dollars, which I always found interesting. And they have the same number of layers in their tissue layers in their embryo. They are at the organ level. They have increased complexity of the muscle system, and they have bilateral symmetry and have appearance of cephalization. The attendance document usually becomes available around 6:20, 6:30 is when I send it, just halfway through. Okay, cool. So next, yeah, no problem. And just so you know, don't get too confused. This is not a whole different thing of phyla. Here we're just continuing on with that invertebrate phyla, but we're talking about their circulatory system, digestive tract, whether or not they have a colon or a nervous system. Any other details that you guys want to throw out, I would love to put in the boxes below. So just remember that periphera were our sponges that we were talking about. Uh-oh. Oh no. Was it that starfish are not bilaterally So what's interesting about starfish is that they have what's called a hidden That's exactly what I just read too. That, but it's because they move in a preferred direction. So, fleeing or having to turn themselves over, they have to lead with a fifth arm, which looks really funny now that I'm seeing images. And so they're technically considered to have such thing as a bilateral symmetry, even though it doesn't look as such. And also, just as biologists, we really do like to try to organize things as best as we can. And I have found it incredibly easy to, within those categories, kind of find things. And I'm like, wait, I don't really know if I would classify that. But because there's so much knowledge out there, I think, it's just easy to throw them in there. And I'm sure Patrick isn't upset about it. Anyway, okay, going back to the sponges. So they have no colon. Their digestive tract is intracellular digestion, which just means that all of their digestion basically happens in the cytoplasm of their cells. There's no tract, no GI tract. It's very, very simple digestion. They don't have a circulatory system. They work primarily with diffusion. And they have no nervous system. They just have simple cell comm or cell communication. For Cnidaria, where we have an example was a jellyfish, we still see no colon. But in the digestive tract, we're actually starting to see, sorry, yeah, the link, no problem. We're starting to see the gastrovascular cavity and some extracellular digestion and still some of that intracellular digestion. So I'm going to put intra and extracellular digestion. And gastrovascular cavity. It has, for its circular system, diffusion and some circulation of fluid via the gastrovascular cavity. So let me just write circulation of fluid via gastrovascular cavity. So we're starting to see more ways other than diffusion to move things around, and we actually also start to see a nerve network within this phyla, which is really cool. So a lot of developments happen within Cnidaria, and a lot of those just have to do with the vascular tract. We're starting to see nerve formation. And so when we move on to Platyhelminthes, we don't see any colon yet. Now we're seeing a more highly branched gastrovascular cavity. And for the circulatory system, we just have the same as before, where we're seeing diffusion still, but we're also seeing circulation of fluid via that gastrovascular cavity, and we can assume that that would be increased knowing now that that cavity is highly branched. For the nervous system, we're seeing a ladder-like nervous system. We're seeing ganglion in the head, and then and also an end. So we're seeing what's going to look like a nerve cell, basically. I'm just going to put ganglion because we're seeing that for the first time. So we're seeing the development of a nerve net. We're seeing the development of a gastrovascular system, which is increasing the complexity of the circulatory system. Now, within nematoda, what I said earlier, we're seeing a pseudocolon, which just means false colon, so it's not considered a true colon. And this is a gut that's not lined with mesoderm, embryonically. So I'm just going to put not lined with mesoderm. And when you hear mesoderm, endoderm, ectoderm, just assume we're talking about an embryo. An example of the platyhelminthes are those flatworms. Yeah. If it is okay with you folks, I might be referring to them as flatworms just because I don't want to hurt your ears anymore with my poor pronunciation. Cool. Okay, so for the digestive tract of these nematoda, we start seeing a one-way digestive tract with a path that's basically just mouth to anus and allows for more energy input per unit time. And this also evolutionarily just allows for that specialization along the digestive tract. For circulatory system, we're seeing a little bit more complexity now that we have this digestive tract. So we're seeing diffusion still. And some facilitation of circulation. Via fluid movement of that hydrostatic skeleton. And here we are seeing a lateral nerve cord. Cords. Annelida. So the colon is a schizocolon formed by the splitting of the mesoderm embryonically. Just had to change that definition. And so it's basically like a colon that's the body cavity lying between the digestive tract and the musculature of the body wall. And that's what happens when you're splitting the mesodermal mass. So it just almost looks like there's the formation of an extra cavity. I'm just going to put splitting of mesoderm. Let me see if I can show you. I'm gonna look up a photo, try to recreate it. I'm also curious. So, okay. All right, so basically what it looks like is I don't know where to draw this, but I'm just gonna draw it here and then erase it. So you have the ectoderm out here, and then on the outside, this is the developing colon. And then we have that middle here that is the gut. So these right here were early mesoderm cells. Those are on the outside. Yes, exactly. So it's pinching off towards the inside. It's moving outside. So these here, you could have thought of the earlier stages of this center gut having these two little mesoderms that are kind of pinching off and going outward and forming these cavities right here. So does that, I hope that makes sense. Okay, cool. Awesome. Alrighty, cool. For their digestive tract, they have the same digestive tract as nematoda. They are one-way digestive, which is just mouth to anus, and that's more energy input unit per time. For their circulatory system, this is the first time we're seeing a closed system. We have heart, arteries, capillaries, and veins. So this one's huge. And in terms of their nervous system, we're finding it to have increased complexity of the previous nematoda that we saw lateral nerve cords in. For Mollusca, we see the same thing that we saw for Annelida. Annelida? Annelida is what I like to say. We see the same thing for their digestive tract, but for their circulatory system, we have some species that have open circulatory systems, some have closed. An example of this would be squid and octopus. And in terms of their nervous system, they have also an increased complexity from those lateral nerve cords. Right, for Arthropoda, we see the same thing once more. And we see the same thing for their digestive tract. So basically, yeah, it's more of diffusion. And yes, the attendance has been shared, but I will share it just once more for you. So They have to, the circulatory system, right, is all about pumping blood. So having an open circulatory system is when they pump blood into a hemocell, and then it just diffuses back into the circulatory system between cells. And a hemocell is a primary body cavity. So it's just what it does is just blood flows through this open cavity, and to be pumped back into the circulatory system, it just diffuses through cells. Yes, mainly just diffusion. It basically is just diffusion. The only reason I say mainly is because of, the flow through the cavity and the diffusing back through the circular and then flowing back. So, yes. Awesome. You guys ask really great questions. Echinodermata is when we see a difference in a colon in a while, where we have an enterocolon. That's formed by outpocketing of the gut. And I'll find a picture to show to you guys or draw for you so that you can see that. What's unfortunate is that I do not have access to your guys' textbook, which usually helps with these photos. Because I feel like it looks pretty similar to schizocolon. I would say, honestly. I'm very sorry about my lack of knowledge on the difference really between these two. But I guess the main difference is that in schizocolon, the mesoderm cells, the early mesoderm cells, form kind of into themselves, whereas in the enterocolon, they kind of bud off from the gut itself. So, for. I don't even know why I wrote it like this. It's definitely shies. So, for enterocolon, the mesoderm cells look like this at first. And for this guy over here, they actually, are more like form, like these are where the mesocell cells are and they kind of migrate upwards, and then here is where they bud out. So I'm sorry about that confusion. Yes, we're going. Oh, shoot, I did not finish the arthropoda section. I'm so sorry. Thank you for bringing that to my attention. Okay, sorry. Circulatory system. Wow, oh my gosh. Yeah, head out if you need to, no problem. I am all over the place. Okay, I'm gonna finish the section and then I will definitely message you privately about how I got this job, or I can just stay for a minute after if that's okay with you. So for their circulatory system, arthropoda have an open circulatory system and they just have increased complexity of nerve cells. Thank you for that. Okay, so moving back, they have an enterocolon formed by outpocketing of gut. So things just kind of come from the center gut and migrate outwards rather than from the endodermic site. And I'm sure that there are more pictures to help this become clearer. They have the same digestive tract, so one-way digestive. Their circulatory system is closed and they have increased complexity of the nervous system. Cool. Alrighty. We do have a few questions to answer that are free response. I will go, of course, until the time is. I'm not sure I'll be able to finish, but I will definitely try my best. So, what set of characteristics is shared by all of the invertebrate animal phyla in the chart? Something that we can say for all of them is all are multicellular heterotrophs. What unique combination of characteristics defines each of the invertebrate phyla as separate from the other phyla? The main thing to look at for this question is that when you just look down on each of the columns, you can kind of determine the characteristics in each phylum, but not one single characteristic defines one phyla, but it's the combination of the different characteristics that define the phyla. If you compare the characteristics of one phylum of the invertebrates with the next, what key difference separates the groups from each other? So this is more, I think, a better exercise for you on your own when you're studying, when you're looking through, finding out the differences for yourself to kind of help navigate ways of remembering. So for example, something that I'm just going to write down for one example is that annelids differ from nematodes in that annelids have both longitudinal and circular muscles. And nematodes have only longitudinal. Oh, I'll actually put the difference in the colon as well. I think that's important. And a schizocolon. Nematodes have only longitudinal muscles. Pseudocolon instead. But in all other aspects, the two phyla are similar. So these are just examples of ways to look at phyla close to one another that you may have trouble differentiating between and finding differences that can stick with you. Those are just a couple of examples. Number four, looking across the rows, what major trends appear to occur in the evolution of various organs or organ systems in these animal groups? So the main way that we organize this chart is for you to kind of see how the various systems changed in the evolution of these different phyla. And the arrangement is supposed to help you guys visualize the major trends in evolution. And so things I'm going to write down, for example, the number of layers in the embryo, you can see change from no differentiation in sponges to 2 in cnidaria and ultimately 3 in those flatworms. And if you look at it this way, it's a lot easier than just having to memorize the characteristics of each phylum. And in this way, you only need to remember where the major changes were introduced. So another example is that these flatworms that have the 3 body layers, once they have those 3 body layers, we can see as a trend that the other phyla also continued to have 3 body layers. So, just something to think about in terms of this question. A lot of these in today's live stream and this week is about helping you find ways to understand these evolutionary trends in animals just a little bit better by looking for these trends in the charts we've provided. Cool, and then from what we said previously, does this analysis provide evidence for or against the statement, quote, evolution adds on to or modifies what already exists? As a parent in the chart, modifications are built upon what already exists. And so we could say that that is for the statement that evolution modifies what already exists. And we could also say to a certain degree that evolution could add on to, because when we're seeing the development of one tissue, it may be easier through I don't know how to say this without being too controversial, but I would say that once something is there, it might be easier to add something else. Yes, I don't want to add any mutation or anything weird. So, the addition, this is an example, addition of the third layer, the mesoderm, is what allowed for the evolution of muscle cells and elaboration of the muscle system. The chart organizes the major groups of animals based on grade or shared body plan features. What changes would you need to make in this organization to reflect the possible phylogenetic relationships uncovered using molecular evidence? So, for this guy, things that I would use is that, recent DNA analysis is really good at seeing where things are related. And so DNA analysis has indicated that among these phyla, nematodes and arthropods should be grouped together. And they would be called or as the ecdysozoa. The next thing is that the echinoderms and the chordates should be listed as the deuterostomia. And that the remaining phyla are classified as Lophotrochozoa. Home stretch, people. Last couple questions. So, 6. Numerous developmental characteristics are used to determine the evolutionary relationships among animal phyla. What developmental evidence was used to link annelids, arthropods, and mollusks evolutionarily? So, developmentally, these are all protozoans, and they all display spiral derminate cleavage, and we see that in the development of their digestive tract. The blastomere becomes the mouth, so we see that in all of these arthropods. We also see the colon forms as a split in the mesoderm, and so that is why we link these three groups together, are because of these three things. Don't get too bogged down in the nitty-gritty of it. Just understand the characteristics that they share. So, wrong place. Alrighty, what evidence is used to separate these phyla from the echinoderms and the chordates? So the echinoderms and the chordates are deuterostomes. So developmentally, they undergo radial cleavage. And in the development of the digestive tract, the mouth forms from a secondary opening. Uh, The blastopore, and the colon forms from the mesodermal outpocketings of the gut rather than a split of the mesoderm itself. And colon. Alrighty. Moving on to that last question. In biological terms, a group of organisms are said to be successful if represented by a large number of species, or if the mass of all the organisms in the group is large. In both cases, large is determined relative to other groups or organisms. Given this definition of success, which of the major groups of animals would you argue is the most successful? And be sure to provide evidence for your argument. So, obviously, answers to this might vary depending on what criteria are chosen. So, for example, if the success was based on total mass, or the total number of organisms, or the total number of different species of organisms within a group, then those numbers would differ. I'm going to give you some examples, of course. So, on one hand, because nematodes are, they're found as ectoparasites. And endoparasites, oh sorry, they're found as both ecto and endoparasites on almost every living organism, and so because they're so abundant, they could be considered the most successful. Nematodes. Nematodes. They are ecto endoparasites. Found on almost every living organism. So, yeah, this is one way they could be considered successful. Any reasonable argument, honestly, as long as it's backed up with evidence, can be considered most successful. We could say, perhaps things that are larger in mass, such as the echinodermata, like starfish, sea cucumbers, urchins, sand dollars, or maybe even within the arthropods, such as lobsters, crabs, can be very large. And so, if that's the case, if we're dealing with mass per organism, then we could also say that the arthropods were most successful. But it all depends on your definition, and success is usually relative, so it's a very flexible term. But yeah, so that brings us to the end here. For the person who sent me that chat about how to get involved with tutoring, I would look specifically at the Learning Center. That is where I got my job. You could also talk to your bio professors. They could get you into some biology tutoring. Right now, I'm a learning assistant for the general chemistry series, and I'm also tutoring the general biology series, and I'm having a lot of fun. So yeah, if you have any more questions about that, I would direct yourself to the Learning Center, and they're always looking for people to tutor. So if you really enjoyed this series and you wanted to tutor next year, I would definitely recommend it. It's a really great experience. It helps you retain the information. Me personally, I'm taking the MCAT coming up soon, and so reviewing biology, reviewing chemistry is really helpful for me. So yeah, I really appreciate your interest in that. Yeah, so getting the job for this, I just contacted the Learning Center. They have a bunch of emails and stuff. Oh, thank you so much. Yeah, I've been studying really hard for it. Thank you. But really, I would direct yourself to the MCAT. I did send you a whisper message with my email. So if you have more questions, just let me know. Thank you guys so much. Have a really nice rest of your night. I hope that midterms aren't too stressful and that you guys are doing well. Of course, let me know if you need any help. Thank you guys. Bye.